is going on, everyone? Welcome to Conspiracy Corner Podcast. This is Abe, your host. I went ahead and I got two podcast episodes planned. I mean, I'm so backlogged, there's always an episode planned. It's just finding the time to do it. So today we're going to be doing a Halloween special episode. It's obviously going to come out a little early. I'm going to post it and edit it and stuff like that so it can come out right after I'm done recording this. But today is going to be a Halloween special. I was trying to think in my head, how do I do a Halloween special for a podcast that, yes, it's Conspiracy Corner Podcast, but it's not specifically only conspiracies. We cover the paranormal, ghost stories, we cover ufology, we cover spirituality, cover witchcraft, we cover secret societies, you know, which that would fall under conspiracy, but I was like, I really don't know, I mean, because I can't, I've already done so many paranormal episodes that it's like, well, I could just tack on Halloween special for anything like that, but I don't know, I was trying to find something weird, something dark, something scary for a Halloween special, so I went ahead and I found this old book that I have, and it's called Curious Punishments of Bygone Days, and it's literally a reprint of an old pamphlet from, like, I think it's like the 1600s, 1700s, something crazy like that. But it's basically just different torture devices. And they're short enough to where I'm like, ooh, I could honestly read these on there and talk about each one, you know. That would be a good, you know, Halloween special, something grotesque and horrible and evil. But I usually like to start out the podcast with kind of an update on how I'm doing and stuff. I took a little hiatus from YouTube, just because, honestly, after that first strike or whatever, or warning or whatever the fuck they gave me, it kind of discouraged me a little bit. I just kind of needed to take a break, kind of reset myself, get myself back on balance, you know? Basically, I've just been working my ass off, man. They scheduled me 48 hours this week, and we've been having, like, corporate and stuff come in, so we've definitely, it's, I don't know, it's a little frustrating. So, I mean, last week I had to stay late several days, which is fine, you know, because I don't mind, because, you know, like, I've figured out basically mathematically that I could survive off, like, what I make in paychecks, but I always try to have, like, $5,000, you know, put back, to make it through a year, like, living humbly, but safely, like, it's a safety net, you know. I had 5Gs like a couple weeks ago, and then I bought a washer and dryer, which the washer works, but the dryer, now we have to get another cord for it, so it kind of put us back a little bit, but knock on wood, I mean, I'll get back up there financially. So I don't mind the extra hours and extra work. It's crazy though, like, I was talking to my buddy, and he's like, well, you don't want too many hours because they'll take more out in taxes. And it's like, honestly, it won't fuck me, because the more taxes I pay this year, like last year when I did my taxes, they were saying basically that I made too much and we almost had to pay in. And I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, I didn't make shit last year. I was struggling like crazy. We ended up losing our apartment, being basically shut down to like one car because we couldn't afford tires to put on the other one. Like, we struggled like hell last year. Like, this is the first time that we are actually stable again. Honestly, it was a downward spiral for about 3 years financially. And this is the first time, knock on wood, that we are, like, stable again. So, it's a relief, man. When you are financially stable after being unstable for so long, like, I can't explain how beautiful that peace of mind is, man. I don't know. It's awesome. I love it. I mean, I'm not going out blowing money or something stupid, but just to be financially stable and be able to lay my head on the pillow and actually sleep without having nightmares and worrying, you know? But yeah, let's get on with the show. Let's see what the first torture device is. And I'm going to have a photo of each torture device, too. So this is the Bilboes. Like Bilbo Baggins. There is no doubt that our faraway grandfathers, whether English, French, Dutch, Scotch, or Irish blood, were much more afraid of ridicule than they were even of sinning. And far more than we are of extreme derision or mockery today. This fear and sensitiveness they showed in many ways. They were vastly touchy and resentful about being called opprobrious or bantering names. By the way, like I said earlier, this is like a super old reprint of a pamphlet. So if the English is a little more older, then that's why. Often running petulantly to the court about it and seeking redress by prosecution of the offender, and they were forever bringing suits and pretty slander and libel cases. Colonial courtrooms bubbled over with scandal and gossip and spite. A creature as obsolete as his name, a makebait. And that word, a makebait, is spelt M-A-K-E-B-A-Y-T, was ever present in the community. Ever whispering slander, ever exciting contention, and often also hailed to court for punishment. Often hailed to court. While his opposite, a makepeace, was everywhere sadly needed. Far-seeing magistrates declared against the makebait as even guilty of stirring up baratery, okay, or as Judge Sewall of Old Boston Puritan termed it, at least yeah, I'm not even gonna pronounce it. It's Gravaminous. Equally with personal libel, did all good citizens and all good Christians fiercely resent of word. Not only of derision or satire, but even of dispassionate disapproval of either government or church. A tithe or the plain-speaking criticism cheerfully endured in politics today would have provoked a civil war 2 centuries ago. While freedom of judgment or expression in religious matters was ever sharply silenced and punished in New England. That ultra-sensitiveness, which made a lampoon, a jeer, a scoff, a taunt, an unbearable and inflaming offense, was of equal force when used against the men of the day in punishment for real crimes and offenses. Sounds like today that just words were, I don't know, too sensitive. Kind of sounds like the social justice movement. And political correctness. So those weren't real offenses, even in this book they're saying. That ultra-sensitiveness, which made a lampoon, a jeer, a scoff, a taunt, unbearable and an inflaming offense. So a war on words, if you say something, it's a crime. Kind of sounds like 2020, like we didn't learn from our past, from the Puritans, you know? By the way, this is the Puritans. So that actually helps knowing that this is like old Puritan punishments from colonial America. So, yeah, it's kind of sad too, because a lot of people, man, I look at the witch trials, the Salem witch trials, as an important part of history that should be taught and learned from. And sadly, I mean, I practice witchcraft, you know, and I sadly get looks and like people like say little snide remarks like, "Oh, so you believe in sacrificing children and shit?" And it's like, "Really, bro?" And I mean, it's something like I don't know. It aggravated me like the other day, man. It was my day off, and I was watching some YouTube movie. It was a free YouTube movie with I'm trying to remember. Kirstie Alley was in it, and it was basically about the Salem witch trials. It was kind of like The Crucible, but with Hollywood. I mean, you know how Hollywood works. They literally like fuck everything up and don't they like change the story, like, 'cause The Crucible was a play. It's a true story, but it's a play. But I don't think with the play that they actually changed too much. But they making it into a movie, and Hollywood gets their nasty fingers on it. Like, they kind of muddled it and like altered it the way that they wanted cinematically. But I mean, it was a good movie. I can't remember the name of the movie. It's probably still on free YouTube movies right now. But the point I was making was I was in the comment section and it was a fucking shit show, dude. Apparently, all the Christians and stuff, not all of them in general, but all the Christians in the comment section were like bashing it, like, this is just satanic propaganda. This is propaganda. This is propaganda. It never happened. They literally were denying that the witch trials ever happened. And I'm like, wait, what the fuck? So I don't know if that's like more division in the conspiracy community, but apparently to a large majority of Christian conspiracy theorists, they apparently don't believe that the witch trials ever happened. I don't know. That's fucking crazy to me. But I don't know. Me personally, I don't see, if it is propaganda, then I don't see what is so bad about it. Because it's basically just saying, hey, we probably shouldn't murder witches. I know plenty of people who have practiced Wicca. I have some family members who practice, and it's like, I don't think that I should burn them at the stake for that. Like, I think that's basically the common sense message of the Crucible, of the Salem witch trials. Even if it is propaganda, I don't see the point of burning people alive. Because they go, oh, abracadabra, if I mix this herb and this herb, I will heal you. Because most people practicing this stuff are honestly just like, you know, doing it for good, like white magic. Sorry to burst your bubble, but there is such a thing. And it's no different than a Christian kneeling down for prayer and praying for someone. I digress. In many, indeed, in nearly all of the penalties and punishments of past centuries, derision, scoffing, contemptuous publicity, and personal obloquy were applied to the offender or criminal by means of demeaning, degrading, and helpless exposure in grotesque, insulting, and painful engines of punishment, such as the stocks, bilboes, which is what we're covering now, pillory, brank, ducking stool or jogs or jugs, I guess, JOUGS, thus confined and exposed to the free gibes and constant mockery of the whole community. The peculiar power of punishment was assented Kindred in their nature and in their force were the punishments of setting on the gallows and of the branding. The latter, whether in permanent form by searing the flesh or by mutilation, or temporarily by labeling with written placards or affixed initials. One of the earliest of these degrading engines of confinement for public exposure to be used in punishment in this country was the Bilboes. Through this instrument, to punish transgressors against ye king's maesty's laws. I don't know what that means, but I guess to punish transgressors against the king's laws. That's what I get from that. Came from Old England. It was by tradition derived from Bilboa. It was alleged that the Bilboes were manufactured there and shipped on board the Spanish Armada in large numbers to shackle the English prisoners so confidently expected to be captured. This occasion may have given them their wide popularity and employment, but this happened in 1588, and in the first volume of Hakluyt's Voyages, and that's Hakluyt spelled H-A-K-L-U-Y-T, Voyages, page 295, dating some years earlier, referenced is made to Bilboes. Bilboes, so they spelt it a little different. B-I-L-B-O-U-S. They were a simple but effective restraint. A long, heavy bolt or bar of iron, having two sliding shackles, something like handcuffs in a lock. In these shackles were thrust the legs of offenders or criminals who were then locked in with a padlock. Sometimes a chain at one end of the bilboes attached both bilboes and prisoner to the floor or wall. But this was superfluous, as the iron bar prevented locomotion. Whether the Spanish Armada story is true or not, bilboes were certainly much used on board ship. Shakespeare says in Hamlet, "Methought I lay worse the mutinies in the bilboes." In Cook's Voyages and other sea tales, we read of bilboo bolts on sailors. The Massachusetts magistrates brought bilboes from England as a means of punishment, refractory or sinning colonist, and they were soon in constant use. And the very oldest court records, which are still preserved, of the settlement of Boston, the Bay Colony, appear the frequent sentences of offenders to be placed in the bilboes. The earliest entry is in the authorized record of the court held at Boston on the 7th of August, 1632. It reads thus: "James Woodward shall be set in the bilboes for being drunk at the New Town." Damn! Public intoxication, and that's how they punish you. I just got 24 hours in jail. Well, actually, my punishment was pretty bad. I got 24 hours in jail for public intoxication. And then broke my neck because I fell off the top bunk after I had a seizure. There's a whole story on that, a whole episode. If you go further back in my channel, just look up my jail story and learn how I basically broke my neck and fell off of top bunk. And so I don't know. Maybe the justice system hasn't changed at all. Yeah, it sucks too, because now I pretty much suffer from vertigo now. Like, I'm dizzy 24/7. You know? I bend down and get up and I'm literally just dizzy. I feel like Jack Sparrow, like, the way he moves sometimes, man. Luckily, it's not noticeable to other people, I don't think. No one's ever commented on it, but, like, I just feel dizzy every time I bend over and get up, and it sucks because I'm a night stalker, too. So, like, literally, I'm just, like, every 2 seconds, I'm just thrown into this world of dizzy. I don't know if it, like, damaged something internally. I had, like, I think it was like three staples and three stitches because I split my head and then I broke my neck. It was fucking brutal. It sucked, man. But yeah, this guy got thrown into court because he was just drunk. Public intoxication. It doesn't really say. I don't know. He might. Yeah, I don't think he did anything else besides just public intoxication, which is pretty shitty that he got that punishment for it. Soon another colonist fell at the Bilboes for selling pieces and powders and shot to the Indians. Ever a bitterly abhorred and fiercely punished crime. And another the same year for threatening, were he punished, he would carry the case to England, was similarly and fearlessly thrust into the Bilboes. Alright, now I'm going to say this. That second crime right there, this is my personal opinion. And let me state this before anyone jumps all over me. I got two tribes of Native American in me. And I got white blood in me. He was selling guns and gunpowder and bullets basically to the Native Americans. And I don't know if you guys like don't know much about history or not. I'm not saying you're ignorant or nothing, but it's something that they kind of have hidden from a lot of history books. Yes, we came over here on the Mayflower and shit, you know, and we were pilgrims and the pilgrims became the Puritans, all that jazz. But I don't know if you guys know this, but it even like kind of gets into it when you read the Crucible. The Native Americans, there's a reason they called them like savage and shit. And I'm not saying any particular tribe or anything, but there was some fucked up shit that they were doing too, like kidnapping little white girls and shit, and would like mutilate them and rape them. And so, I mean, there's a reason why I think the dude should have had worse punishment than the Bilboes. Honestly, I think he should have been executed for treason or something. But they were doing fucked up shit too. And you won't see that on the Walt Disney, you know, propaganda Pocahontas stuff. But, and this is someone who is part Native American and white. So I see both sides of the story. I've studied both sides of the story. Honestly, there's a lot of fucked up shit on both ends. But you'll never hear that from a mainstream academia that, hey, the Native Americans were kind of fucking evil and savage and pagan. You know, they were kidnapping little white girls and stuff. They basically had to stay in the village. Unless you were a man with a gun, you could not go to the woods. Like, if you were a little girl, you know, back in England, they could go, hey, go out to the woods and go get some sticks, some kindle for the fireplace. You couldn't do that in America. All the little girls and all the women were literally on lockdown, quarantine. So you guys think you're quarantined right now? Imagine being a Puritan in your little village. And being a white woman, you were definitely quarantined, dude. Because a lot of the Native Americans, man, were snatching up white women, snatching up little girls, and raping them and sacrificing them and doing crazy shit. And this is like historical fact. If you dig deep enough, you'll find that shit. So there was evil on both sides. But yeah, he was selling Indians guns, ammo, and gunpowder. Let's see. Ever a bitterly abhorred and fiercely punished crime, and another the same year for threatening, were he punished. He would carry the case to England, because this is back when we were still technically under English control, before the Revolution. Before the Illuminati. Which, hey, I discussed that too, man. If it were not for the Illuminati and Freemasons and stuff, we wouldn't be free in America. Just saying. So there is some good things they did. We're the new Atlantis. Wake up. Then troublesome Thomas Dexter, with his ever ready tongue, was hauled up and tried on March 4th, 1633. Here is his sentence. Thomas Dexter shall be set in the Bilboes, disfranchised, and fined 15, I don't know what that symbol is, but I'm guessing it's like 15 coins or something. I don't know. that currency is foreign to me. It's 1600s. And this is literally, my wife's giving me a weird look. This is literally a reprint of a pamphlet from the 1600s. It's wicked shit, man.
No, I was going to say it's probably a pence.
Have you seen it? Check it out. Pence?
Well, I already know.
Wonder if that's how Pence got his name. This right there. An L with a swirl.
That's the pounds.
Pounds? Yeah, so they, oh yeah, they still had English pounds, yeah, I'm guessing. Yeah.
The same currency would be then.
Okay, because we were still under English control.
Yeah, and we hadn't switched to ourselves yet.
So there you go. Sorry about my ignorance. Destroy me in the comments. For specking, and by the way, this is not me speaking like this. For specking ripful and seditious words, agat, the government here established. That's literally how it's spelled. Specking the ripful and sedit. You can even back me up so that way they don't think I'm crazy, boo. What does this say?
Yeah, for specking.
Ripful.
Yeah. Reproachful. I think it's supposed to be.
That's how it's spelled, though?
Yeah. Well, honey, you already know. Okay. I said that word.
Yeah, so, yeah. Just so you know, I'm not batshit. And, like, the last podcast I did, like, I don't know if people are scared to, like, thumbs up it because they think I'm drunk or fucking insane or something, but I had to speak Gaelic on the last podcast. So, this is old English, and I can barely fucking read it. And then on the last podcast, I'm speaking literally ancient Gaelic. People are like, Abe's off his rocker. No, that's literally how it's printed. He's also suffered in the Bilboes for cursing. Wow, he got, just for cussing, he got sent, basically locked up in the Bilboes. Which, here you go. That's what it looks like. Talking to my wife, I'm going to post the picture on the podcast for you. She's sweeping the floor. Yeah, for cussing, the other one got it locked in that for PI, man, public intoxication.
Well,
here, if you're going to chime in, I'm going to give you the microphone. Which is fine. We're just live, so.
Yeah, I was just going to say, like, you know, it makes sense why nowadays even still people are very against cursing, because this is something that was even back then. It's still, it just shows how much something can be greatly ingrained. It can show how something can be greatly ingrained into us even years later.
Right.
Hundreds of years later at that.
Well, I believe there's power in words too.
Oh, yeah. No, that's why I like a certain manga for a reason. I love that one because it's all about how words are spoken through spelling and stuff.
Yeah. I don't know, but you can't project your voice as good as that.
No, that's good, but that's good.
Alright, man. Where the fuck was I, dude? Well, shit. Let me pause it. Alright, sorry about that. I lost my place. He also suffered, yeah, at the Bilboes for cursing. So this we're still going on this guy's punishment. All he said was, "Damn ye come." That's it. That was what was so bad. "Damn ye come." And he got locked in the Bilboes for saying the D word, damn. So honestly, man, we were not very free back then. Like, honestly, starting to look at it, the laws were stricter back then. We should probably count our blessings on our freedoms we have now. Thomas Morton of Maremount, that amusing old debauchery and roasterer, was sentenced to be clapped into the Bilboes. And he says the harmless salvages stared at him in wonder, like, poor silly lambs, as he endured his punishment. And doubtless some of the indesses, gay lasses, in beaver coats, who had danced with him around his merry maypole and had partaken on his cask of claret sparkling neat, sympathized with him and cheered him in his indignity. The next year, another Newtown man, being penitent, Henry Bright, was set in the Bilboes for swearing, and that's how it's pronounced, swearing, not swearing, swearing. Another had sleeted the magistrates in speeches. In 1635, on April 7th, Griffin Montagne shall be set in ye Bilboes for stealing boards and clapboards, and enjoined to move his habitacon. All right, gotcha. Within a year, we found offenders being punished in two places for the same offense, thus degrading them far and wide. And when in Salem, they were set in the stocks. Dude, I'm gonna start talking like this at work. Do you steal clappards for your habitations? I'll set you in the stockings. Like, oh my god, the way they used to speak back then, it's not even fucking English. But the sad thing is,
it's English.
It's English.
Yeah, old English to me is very unique in the way that they spoke. I actually do kind of, sometimes I'm like, man, why don't we still talk like that?
Dude, I ain't gonna lie, like, this book, like, it's two birds, one stone, because I've always wanted to read this book. I've had this book for years.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to have more fun reading this book just for, like, shits and giggles on how they talked back then compared to now. Which, I mean, I live in Kentucky, so, like, I'm sure I've had people comment, and they weren't being mean, but they commented, dude, I love your southern drawl. Something about your voice, like,
you know, the other day.
I love it. Like, it's soothing, they said, and it's like... That's just what I picked up from Kentucky. That and living in the deep south, you know?
But not to probably go on top of you talking about language, right? I actually did have a customer the other day, like last week. He was just like, he looked at me kind of weird, like, and was like, where are you from? Of course, I'm kind of like off guard, like, what are you asking? But I went, I'm around here. And he still kind of gave me that weird look, like, because he was trying to figure out my accent.
Right.
And I was like, I'm from Kentucky, Judson County. And he was like, you don't sound like you're from here. You don't have an accent. And I was, he's like, I'm sorry. I had to say, I was like, oh, no, dude. Like, it didn't bother me, but at the same time, I'm going, how can I not have an accent from here? I've lived here.
People say weird shit, though, too. Like, and honestly, like, listening to old recordings of me. Like, because, yes, I re-listen to my shit just in general, just because I like to do quality checks. But sometimes you can really hear that draw that I picked up from, honestly, being married to my ex-wife, which was a fucking hillbilly. Like, we legit were, like, hillbilly. I'm talking, like, collecting rainwater to wash the dishes, collecting rainwater to wash or to flush the toilet, because we did not have indoor plumbing. I'm talking like holes in the floor to where you could see the dirt underneath the house. No heat, no air. This was hillbilly as fuck, dude. You walked in the house and there's like 10 people living there. That's a little bit of an over-exaggeration. There was like, I think like 8 people living there, including me. And then we had literally, like, 10 dogs in the house. Like, this was hillbilly as fuck, dude. I slept on a couch for, like, years. And honestly, my current wife actually had to break that habit out of me of sleeping on couches.
Yep.
Because I literally was so adjusted to it, that hillbilly mindset, that I was like, it took how long for you to break me out of the habit of sleeping on a couch? Here you go. We're going to get deep psychologically. This is how fucked up I am. Until then.
Literally, I'm only just now getting you to. And I already had this film that if we had a couch in the house,
I'd crash on it.
Yeah.
I'd move to it.
Yeah, so I'm kind of like, you know, I'm kind of glad I don't have that couch anymore. So that way I can make you go to bed.
I'm actually fine with not having it.
Same.
Honestly.
Honestly, too, though, I'm still trying to break you of some of your hillbilly stuff. Where you're like, no, man, like, it's fine. I'm going, no!
Right.
I don't want to do that.
Yeah. She's a little more proper. Yes, some of it's not all hillbilly though, man. No. Some of it honestly is like punk rock shit, dude.
Yeah.
Like I used to stay the night at rat houses, man. Do you guys know what rat houses are? It's literally, okay, here's a rat house. A rat house is basically the punk equivalent to like
hillbillies?
Pretty much hillbillies. You got literally a rat house can be like, you'll find an abandoned house, and there'll be like 10 punks just staying the night there. Or, I mean, I've stayed in rat houses, man. Like, pretty much like houses that should be torn down and destroyed for hygiene reasons and stuff. It's literally that disgusting. Like, you'll have like 10 or 20 punks, man. Because I'm like an OG punk. And I'm not bragging or nothing, but it cracks me up when I see, like, all these people, like, oh, you know, like, I was punk rock, man. Like, this is punk rock. Which, punk rock is dead. I mean, let's just face it. But I was OG fucking punk, dude. I've stayed the night in rat houses and shit, so, like, I don't know. Like, I'm the type, like, I'd spit on the ground while I'm talking to you and not think twice about it. But to some people, they'd be like, oh my God, he's disgusting. Or I'd blow a snot rocket in front of you. And it's just like, I'm just thinking of it like, oh, I have this medical condition that I have a runny nose right now. I don't have a tissue. You know, snot rocket. Continue the conversation. And most people would be like, he's so vile. It's like, wait, what? What did I do wrong? You know? Yeah, it's a lot of untraining. Well, yeah, you try not to spit, but imagine me, I had pneumonia like 6 times.
Oh, no. If I have a reason to, like because I'm sick, because there is something genuinely stuck up in there or something, no, yeah, I'm going to spit it out.
Right.
It to the best of my ability, because like, keep swallowing and keeping it in your body does not help you get over your sickness. I feel like the more you get it out, the better you're gonna start feeling.
Right.
So like, why would I keep swallowing it and shit?
Yeah, I mean, your body tells you this shit needs to come out.
That and it's like, what was the other thing I was particularly on that one? It's just that I'm gonna try not to do it in front of others.
Right.
But again, it's something I can't always promise. If there's nowhere for me to go privately to get it out, sorry.
Well, I think it's different for you though because you have. Honestly, that, and I'm a social justice warrior, you know that. But
yeah.
Honestly, oops, sorry, I got hiccups. That patriarchal view of you're a lady. You can't, you're not allowed to be gross.
Oh, actually, no, it has nothing to do with that. Yeah. I just understand that some.
You don't think it's that on the subconscious or
unconscious
level? No, that, I with you?
No, I honestly see it as a. Respectful thing because I understand not everyone will find this.
So it's kind of like an honor thing.
Yeah. So there are going to be people who find it very disgusting, and I understand that. I find certain things disgusting.
How very Eastern of you. Sorry, I'm Western.
Well, no, see, now Mama has it ingrained in her.
Well, she's Western, and she's a cowgirl, and I'm a cow fucking boy.
But nonetheless, yeah, she tried to ingrain it into me in that aspect of look of,
right.
Well, you shouldn't do that because it's not very ladylike, but I was like, that makes no sense, sorry, now. I'll do it out of respect because not everyone's going to find it very, you know, nice, but I'm not going to do it because, oh, I'm a lady. No, I ain't that lady.
Behold, my lady. I love that song.
I gotta be going now.
Alright, well, I'm gonna finish this podcast. I'm almost done with this, and I'm gonna edit it. And have a good day at work.
Alright. Thank you.
All right, so I digress. Where were we at? Yeah, he was swearingin'.
Swearingin'.
Yeah. That's where it all started from, was I was going to start talking like that from now on.
Yeah, I don't blame you.
All right, let's skip to the next paragraph. We're almost done with the Bilboes. Honestly, I thought I would be able to get at least, like, two torture devices in on this episode, but I think I'm going to save them for individual episodes. Let me know in the comments. Give a thumbs up if you like, you know, covering a different torture item each episode. This is a series that I would like to, like a sub-series that I would like to kind of do. I haven't given up on the Secret Society series. I'm almost done. The last one I have to cover is the Assassins. So, check that out. That'll be coming out. But we're going to go ahead and finish off this Halloween special, The Bilboes, the torture device. It is high noon in Boston, and the year is 1638. The hot June sun beats down on the little town, the narrow paths, the wharfs, and sweet fern and cedars on the common give forth a pungent, dry, hot scent that is wafted down to the square where stands the governor's house. The market, the church, the homes of the gentlefolk. A crowd is gathered there. Some interesting object in the middle of the square. Visitors from Newtown and Salem, Puritan women and children, tawny Indian braves in wampum and war paint, gaily dressed sailors from two great ships lying at anchor in bay. All the staring and whispering and jeering and biting the thumb. Love you. They are gathered around a Puritan soldier, garbed in trappings of military behavior. Bravery. Sorry. I got distracted, man. I got dropped a kitten and... What up, boo? You leaving? I love you. Yet in but sorry plight, for it is training day in the Bay Colony, and in spite of the long prayer with which the day's review began, or perhaps... Before the pious opening prayer, Sergeant John Evans has drunken too freely of old sack or alicant, and the hot sun and the sweet wine has sent him reeling from the ranks in disgrace. There he sits sweltering in his great coat, basted with cotton wool and thus made defensive agent Indian arrows. Weighed down with his tin armor, a heavy corslet covering his body, a stiff gorget guarding his throat, clumsy tasses protecting his thighs, all these neatly varnished black, and costing 24 shillings apiece of the town's money. Over his shoulder hangs another weight, his bandolier, a strong, neat's leather belt, carrying 12 boxes of solid cartridges and well-filled bullet bag. And over all, and heavier than all, hangs from his neck, as of lead, the great letter D. Still from his wrist dangles his wooden gun rest, but his bastard musket and snap hands lies with a pike degraded into dust. The sergeant does not move at the jeers of the sailors, nor turn away from the wandering stare of the savages. He cannot move. He cannot turn away. For his legs are firmly set in the strong iron bilboes which John Winthrop sternly brought from England to the new land. Poor John Evans! Your head aches from the fumes of the cloying sack. Your legs ache from the bonds of clogging bilboes. Your body aches from the clamps of your trumpery armor. But you will have to sit there in distress, in an obloquy, till a Serb, old John Norton, the pious Puritan preacher, will come to chide you, as is his wont, to point out to fellow citizens and to visitors your sinful way, the disgracing bilboes, and the great letter that brands you as a drunkard, that D upon you. The decade of life of the Boston Bilboes was soon to end. It was to be laid flat, as Sir Matthew Hale would say. A rival entered the field. In 1639, Edward Palmer made for Boston with the planks and woodwork a pair of stocks. Planks and woodwork were plentiful everywhere in the New World, and iron workers, at first equally scarce, so stocks soon were seen in every town, and the Bilboes were disused. Sold, perhaps, for old iron, wherein they gained did good service. In Virginia, the Bilboes had a short term of use in the earliest years of the settlement. The provost marshal had a fee of 10 shillings for laying by the heels, and he was frequently employed. But there also stocks and pillory proved easier of construction and attainment. I would not be old severe upon the Bilboes and their special use in those early colonial settlements. There had to be some means of restraint of vicious and lawless folks, of hindering public nuisances, and a prison could not be in a day. The Bilboes seemed an easy settlement of the difficulty. Doing effectually with one iron bar what a prison cell does with many. It was not their use, but the glare of publicity that was offensive. They were ever placed on offenders in the marketplace, in front of the meeting house on lecture day, on market day, not to keep prisoners in lonely captivity, but in public, obliquely. And as has here been cited, for what appear to us today, slight offenses. So there you have it. There's the first torture device, which we covered, the Bilboes. I hope you all enjoyed. I hope you all had a good time listening to our Halloween special. This is Abe Williams signing out. This has been Conspiracy Corner Podcast, the Halloween special episode. Let us know in the comments what you think about our channel. Please like and share and subscribe. We can also be found on Spotify. Here we go. Actually, let's see. We're sponsored by Anchor. We can be found on Spotify, Google Podcast, Breaker, and Radio Public. So if you want to support us on those channels, please do on those platforms, Spotify, Google Podcast, Breaker, and Radio Public. Please do. Because we don't do this for money, but if you do listen to us on those particular sites, we get a penny. We get a penny for every listen. So we do not have a Patreon. We do not have anything like that. We aren't selling merch right now because we haven't actually saved up enough money to sell merch. I do this channel because I love doing this. This is my hobby. This is my passion. I would love to turn it into a career. If it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. I'm still going to do this because I love you all. I love my fans. That, and I want to get the truth out there. You know, this is not a heavy-hitting episode, but I feel like we might have made some good points here and there, and maybe it'll red pill some people, and maybe it won't. But, I don't know. I hope you all enjoyed, and happy Halloween!
Strange, come with us and you will see this our town of Holland. good scale. I've done so job, but when I think of it, in our town of Halloween, in this town, don't we love it now? Everybody's waiting for the next.